everybody. Thanks. Mindtree has really been honored and proud to work with Unilever for so many years, almost as long as Mindtree has been around. Mindtree is a technology solutions and services company headquartered both in Bangalore, India, and just down the road in Warren, New Jersey. When we started with Unilever, it was pretty much the way we started with everybody. People chose Mindtree because we were these nice, hardworking guys and gals. But then over time, we developed a lot of expertise. So today, our goal is to help deliver technology solutions that make our clients prosper the way Unilever has prospered. So with Unilever, we've now gone from just a small operation with Hindustan Unilever back in the year 2000 to 700 of our 13,000 employees, all pervasive within different projects at Unilever. So with that, let me introduce our speaker. Now, Roch Boucher has been with Unilever for 28 years. He's done engineering, he's done IT, he's been a leader within supply chain, he's been a leader within manufacturing. So Roch has done it all. He spent the last 6 years around driving consumer engagement and trade, and the last 4 years specifically globally managing innovation for IT. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Roch Boucher.
Thanks, Paul. All right. Let's set the context a little bit about Unilever. We have the privilege of touching 2 billion consumers every day, and that's a privilege for us. Now, we do that. Let's try this again. We do that because we're operating in about 190 countries. We've got about 50 billion turnover. But more importantly, we're in about 57% of our revenues coming in from D&E markets. So we have a fairly broad reach in terms of what we do from a trade funds perspective. We've got the modern markets, we've got the D&E markets, and it's spread pretty well equally. And we've had to understand how to adapt and deal with all these different markets in the different parts of the globe. Those are a bunch of numbers. If you want to talk a little bit about the Unilever DNA, I'm going to suggest that you take a look at the website, you pull up the sustainable living plan that we have, and you take a look at a lot of the social stuff that we're doing. Whenever people ask me about Unilever, this is the one area that I have a lot of pride in for working with Unilever. So I invite you to go to the website, take a look at it. Topic of conversation for today is around promotions. That's the abstract that was read out. I just want to set expectations. If your expectation is within 30 minutes of my talk, you'll have answers to problems that have plagued our industry for over a decade. You will probably leave the room disappointed. If within 30 minutes of my talk, I resonate some things with you, you have an opportunity to think about things a little bit differently because I prepared the presentation maybe a little bit differently than people would expect, then I think that's been a win. And that's my intent at this point. We have tons of information that is coming at us in terms of trade information every day. And sometimes it's easy to get sort of overwhelmed with the things that we hear. And I'd suggest to you that one of the things you should do is step back and take a look at a macro trend. And I think the macro trend that is pertinent here is that we're living in a world that is volatile, it's uncertain, it's ambiguous, and it's complex, or a VUCA type of world. And if you're living in that kind of world and you're operating in that kind of world, then I think the question is, how do you survive? How do you thrive in that kind of world? And the old way of, you know, getting some market research, putting together, you know, A plus B plus C and getting a deterministic answer and following that, I'm not sure applies anymore. And I think that one of the ways to do that is you start doing a number of things, a number of activities, and what I've called levers here that will increase your chance of success to have some promotions that are value additive. And that's what I'm going to talk about today, is some of those levers. Excuse me. I think there's a number of levers. I'm going to start with one that I think is probably the base. Okay. You need to ensure the presence of a strong process framework in the business. There's a number of myths that I typically run into. Markets are all different. There's no commonality. D&E markets really don't need to care for this sort of stuff, which, you know, we've proved is not correct. Or the opposite, which is one global process needs to be adhered by all. I think from a practice perspective, what we found seems to work is if you set up that business framework and it allows a level of flexibility and it fundamentally understands and recognizes that different markets and different operating companies in those markets are at an evolution They're evolving over a series of stages. Then you start getting a robust framework for how you want to deal with trade funds. I think the challenge around that kind of thought and the kind of concept is it's years in the making. It takes years of constant pressure, certainly on a global stage, and constant senior support in order to get there. How does that look, you know, from a Unilever perspective? You see here one of the types of charts that's been a seminal chart for us to understand how to look at our markets. You've got a number of classifications on one side, and you've got a number of stages, specifically five stages, across the other axis. Those stages represent the evolution that we see in terms of the market conditions and the attributes that you've got. We've been very careful about defining what those attributes are at the stage of that particular market. And the ability to frame the problem in that way has allowed us to start asking some different questions, and it's allowed us to think about type A markets and type B markets. And therefore, that's opened up some thoughts around, is it really one solution or is it multiple solutions? It's not happy. I think one of the other levers you can play is around analytics. Tons of conversations around analytics. I'm going to talk a little bit about backward-looking analytics and forward-looking analytics. I think there's a myth, certainly that I see within our business community very often, that it can be bought easily, just go outside, pick it up, buy it, or that it's easy to implement. You know, Roch, you've got the data in the data warehouse, just put it together and report on it. I think that the practice is a little bit different. I think the analytics and the correct use of data is fundamentally a corporate asset, and it's a differentiating asset. And if you're going to treat it as an asset, I think you've got to treat it with the correct level of investment and the correct level of support. Okay? And that support also translates into the organizational structures and constructs that you need to do that and maintain it. And it's not something that's going to be built in a day. It's an asset. It takes time, and organizationally it takes time to get there. I think parts of the challenges around this particular area, and other people have talked more at length about this, is really understanding how to get your data. It's not a trivial exercise, certainly not on a global stage, it's not. Choosing where you actually want it to reside. There's a whole series of issues around normalizing that data, getting it fit for purpose, and then correctly exposing the data to your user community. And then don't forget the need to upgrade the skill sets of those user communities, because that's typically not in there. There's also another challenge, I think, which is doing so at a cost point that is effective and doing it in a way that is timely. So waiting for 8 to 10 months these days for reporting to come out is not an acceptable solution, certainly not within Unilever. How does that translate to Unilever? We've been very specific in terms of our strategy around analytics. And we've developed the 7 elements of revision. It goes across people, tools, and systems, and data. It involves everything from our information teams to where we want to locate them, to how we want to present the information, to one source of the truth, to the kinds of analytic packages we put on top, to what we choose and how we run our data warehouses, and then, of course, the whole area around master data management. Okay. There's been also an overarching theme around simplification of the information that pervades all of this, because just putting out 1,000 sets of reports is not useful for everybody. So we've got to simplify it down. Now, if you do all of that and you do it correctly, you get to a point where you can do some very sophisticated reporting. But it's done as a matter of course. It is now the ante into the game, if you want. So period over period, bubble charts, waterfall type charts that you see in the bottom, the ability to drill down, the ability for self-service on our client communities in order to do that, that now becomes a matter of course. But it's taken years to get there, and it's taken an investment in an asset. I had talked a little bit about the forward-looking analytics, and that's the optimization piece. And that's an area that gets a lot of attention across everybody that I talk to. I think there's a number of myths around that. First of all, the first myth is it's ready for prime time. So it's available, it works, just put it in. I think one of the other myths that I think is very dangerous is it's perceived sometimes as being the holy grail, which is if you do optimization correctly, then you don't need to worry about some of the other things that you've got to do. You still need to do all the other blocking and tackling. That's never going to go away. In terms of practice, the reality is if you had problems getting the post-event analytics or the rearward-looking view working, you're going to have an even bigger challenge trying to look forward in the future. How you put your data sets, how you choose to normalize them, is going to make a material difference on the accuracy of your outcome and your predictability. So time and effort needs to be spent there. You need to understand, you absolutely have to segment your customer categories, because it's not going to all work together. Okay? And then there's a whole concept around you need to choose an appropriate level of a solution, which I'll get into in the next slide. I think there's a number of challenges around optimization. The math is frankly understood by few, and even fewer typically within an organization. The need to normalize that data, ensure the validity of the data, is critical. I can't understand or understate that enough, or overstate that enough. You need to develop models. They need to be done correctly from day one, but more importantly, they need to be maintained going forward. And the frequency that you need to maintain them, you need to decide. But don't think you've built it once, it can keep running forever. Integration is going to be a challenge. Immaterial of the complexity in which you choose to do optimization is various grades of that, excuse me, you're going to have an integration challenge. That's not going to go away. Because of the type of math and because of the sorts of things that are happening in there, it's typically perceived by your customer base as a black box. And a black box equals no trust. And so that leads to a major organizational change management issue. That's not going to go away. You need to start addressing it up front. In terms of how does that translate in some of our thinking, you've got a continuum in terms of what you want to do for optimization. You've got at one end a level of minimal optimization, which is playbooks, that sort of stuff. You've got at the other end a level that can be highly automated, okay, with a lot of constraint type engines and what-if type scenarios and so on and so forth. But you need to understand where your user community is going to function and where your benefit stream is going to come from. And you've got to choose where along those axes you're going to play. I think the objectives haven't changed. Okay? You're still trying to get that joint revenue with your customers or the category increase. So it's the same across, but how you choose to activate those. And you will continue to have issues, and those issues are going to get worse the further you go towards the optimization piece around mapping, specifically product, customer, and time. Those are things that you've got to book the time in order to deal with correctly. I think one of the other levers you can play is ensuring the deployment of fit-for-purpose solutions. I've purposely put an S in brackets there. I think there's a myth that one solution will fit all of your needs. There's a counteracting myth, which is more than one solution is going to be too expensive. And I think the practice that I'd suggest is your processes are really at different levels of maturity. The actual process itself is at a different level of maturity. The solutions are at a different level of maturity. And you need to understand how to fit your solution to that maturity level in order to choose and make the right choices. I think you need to remove some of the noise that you're going to run into by focusing diligently on benefit realization and be absolutely crystal clear what is driving the benefits for the organization. And this way you get rid of some of the extraneous stuff that seems to happen. Big fan of using pilots to learn. There's a lot of organizational learning that needs to happen. So big fan of using pilots in the appropriate places. And the use of stage releases. If you build too much up front, it will be a bridge too far. You're never going to finish your build. You're never going to get it embedded in the business. It becomes a bridge too far. Challenges, you know, it is going to complexify your landscape. Integration will be a challenge. It's not going to go away. Longer programs really run the risk of failure, and I think it's geometrically risking the failure. So you've got to keep the scope tight, and you've got to control that. Having said that, there are some business segments where you've got to get a foundation in, and sometimes those foundations, especially when they have to get hooked into ERP systems, they will take time. But if you have that need, make sure you do it, and you do it very quickly, or certainly as quickly as you can. Again, how does that translate? In terms of us, you know, I talked a little bit about TPM, I talked around event analytics, talked about optimization. I didn't talk about joint business planning, which is really a collaboration piece. But what you see here is typically how we like to think about it in terms of that accretive value in terms of you know, building one on top of the other. You also see within this chart the representation of what I had called type A and type B type markets, realizing that type A's don't need everything that you've got on the stack. Okay? But the problem that you find is as your capabilities are building going towards your right, the maturity of the solutions that are available for you to use is going the other way. And the question then is how do you resolve that problem? How do you resolve that? And one of the ways that we do it is around the concept of stage layering or layering. And in its simplest form, or one of its simplest forms, if you start thinking about a model where you think about systems of records, systems of differentiation, and systems of innovation, and you start mapping it in that particular way, and you choose those four capabilities I just talked about, TPMP, AJVP, and TPO, and you map those across, you start seeing some different conversations you can possibly have. Okay? Your base TPM system, guys, the processes are well understood. And it really falls within the concept of the systems of record. So you should just go ahead and just get that thing built and move on. I would argue that the anti-instakes around reporting is the same thing. It's really a build. It becomes a system of record. Yeah, maybe you can do some level of differentiation, certainly around some of the top-end analytics. And maybe you want to consider that in terms of pilots. But you should be spending your time building. You start getting around the collaboration space, and then you're talking around differentiating and systems of differentiation. And at that point, you start talking about the use of pilots to learn, live pilots with real customers. And then as you keep going on to complexity, then the concept around optimization comes up. And I think optimization stands right now at the proof of concept level, where you want to run some proof of concepts. You want to try some things. You want to see what happens. You want to see if the benefits are there. You want to see if you can embed it within your organization. So the concept of layering to help you focus and understand what you want to do with your solution stacks. I think another lever we have to pull is around usability and adoption. It's great to build a technical solution that is fully working, but if you can't land it in the customer and the user communities, it's not going to make a difference. I think there's a number of myths that I typically come into. So the myth of if you build it, they're going to come. If you train, they're going to accept it. And if you measure it, you're guaranteed the outcome you're looking. And I think in practice, what really happens is change management is not dealt with correctly. It's typically not a focus. And it typically needs to be built in upfront during the program process in order for it to be successful. And it needs to focus on that usability and adoption. Now, there's different types that you can do. Agile development is one. Most people know how to do that. The use of modeling to engage and define with people is another thing you can do. Gamification is starting to get a lot of buzz these days, and I think there's a room and a place for gamification. Your user interface, you need to make the choice to invest in a good UI. And a good UI is not necessarily or is not only nice-looking, clean, snazzy screens. It's actually the process. It's actually how many steps you need to take. It's around the intuition that is built in so that the user doesn't have to go navigating all over the place. And I don't want to forget about training. You still require training even with all that. I think some of the challenges that you find here, it's a very different way of operating than a typical waterfall project that everybody seems to have gotten used to. It's not necessarily understood by your partners, and it's not necessarily understood by your internal clients. And the first time you put one of your internal clients in front of an agile development where things are failing and things don't work and things don't look good, it takes a leap of faith for them to keep going with you the next several weeks or months in order to develop something that looks good. So you need to develop that capability with them. And I think it's harder to lock in some definitive contracts. How does that look for us? I think in terms of the modeling process, what's important for us is we start with the concept of scenario ideation. Then we start building models at the low and medium fidelity. And then we move to the high fidelity, which makes it look nice and sexy and really attractive. But we spend a lot of time at the beginning on the scenario ideation and the low fidelity to get the processes right, to make sure there's not too many clicks, to make sure that the navigation is actually intuitive and easy to use. We typically have a saying that if we can take an individual who has process expertise and knowledge in the business, and we can put him in front of a screen with no training, and they can find their way, then that is a good user experience at that point. And that's the kind of thing that we're trying to evolve to and get to. I want to talk a little bit about gamification. In its simplest form, gamification is that, you know, the old model, the carrot and the stick, is gone. The new model is really around the challenge, the sense of achievement and the dopamine effect that happens afterwards. And the powerful thing about this is the achievements can be done on so many different levels, personal, social, material, whatever, that it is applicable in quite a few cases. How does that translate into some of the things that we do? Well, we start, for example, in terms of being very, very clear on the KPIs that we want to measure. And once we've done that, then we start talking about the kind of gaming techniques that we want to put into play. And there's different types of gaming techniques. You've got, you know, us versus the machine. You've got, you know, me versus my peers. You've got competitions. There's different techniques that you can use. And then once we've got that, then we start choosing the reward mechanisms. And typically what we found is the reward mechanisms become much more powerful when they're actually tied into social and social type values, which is where we found that the Unilever Sustainable Living Plan is such a powerful leverage platform for us. Okay. Now, how does that translate into sort of one of the games? Well, you've got this progression of yellow belt to red belt to green belt. You know, we didn't put the black belt, but you've got a progression around key metrics. You've got a progression around the individual reaching those. And then that individual continues to go up what we call, you know, the green ladder. And they get more and more social recognition across that Unilever Sustainable Living Plan as we go forward. And it becomes a very, very powerful force for change. I think people seem to think that usability is restricted to custom applications. And I think if you start and you diligently take and make the effort for usability, what you're going to find is you can take an old dog that doesn't look too pretty on the right-hand side, and you can make it look and function pretty well. But you need to make the effort. You need to take the hard decisions in order to get there. I think one of the other levers that you've got that you can play with is around implementation, and then a little bit of maintainability afterwards. I think there's typically a myth that I see that if you can specify it correctly, if you can actually do that, any competent vendor can run with it. And then the corollary is that, you know, if you can build it right, then it's easy to hand off into a support group afterwards when it does break, because it will break sooner or later. And I think one of the practices that I'd suggest is the need to develop a trusted IT partner that will support you. I think you need to develop a mechanism, what we call a delivery framework, to continuously improve quality with that particular vendor. Okay? I think you need to think of speed as your ally and try and get things done and move on. You know, 3-4 year programs are really, really tough to keep moving. And of course, get your support services involved. Whoever your support services are going to be, get them involved as early as possible, because it's going to allow the transition to happen. I think one of the challenges that I've run into is there's a perception that you're going to lose some kind of contractual leverage, and you're not going to get some of the best costs. And I think that's a perception. Again, let's talk a little bit about how that translates for us. This is the delivery framework that we've used successfully with Mindtree. We started this particular framework probably about 2 years ago when we started a very specific delivery for a solution stack. And it's built on a couple of things. It's built on getting it first time right, on time in full, no errors. Okay? We're at the point now where we're doing product releases where we capture no incident tickets afterwards, with thousands of users on the systems, multiple customers or multiple countries on the systems, and we're at that point where we can do that now. And a lot of the things around that were around moving from lagging indicators to leading indicators and catching issues and potential issues much earlier on in the development cycle before it gets released into the customers and the clients. I think there were a number of process levers, internal, you know, alignment process, contractual levers that we put in. Whether they were the contracting principles we agreed, whether the kinds of estimating models we put in, you know, the concept of a global template and the adherence to that template certainly supported that. And then there's also a joint rigor in terms of managing a demand funnel. So both groups could manage the upcoming demand that was coming in from the MCOs in the countries. We've done a lot of work around people engagement, around common target setting between the two groups. Alignment to the Unilever ways of working. There's been a lot of work around embedding a lot of the Mindtree minds or the Mindtree folks into some of the teams, to the point where I always get great sort of pleasure when I hear a Mindtree person actually speak on behalf of Unilever and hold somebody else to account on Unilever's account. And it's when I hear those sorts of things that I know that we've worked in the right direction. We've managed to do all those things correctly, and we've seen that actually the costs have gone lower, and we've been able to reinvest into the product. And in the process of doing all this over the past 2 years, when we started tracking some of the metrics, our defect counts have gone down. I can't see the screen. Apologies, about 80% or so. I know that the testing has gone down about 90%. And that has allowed us now to actually get into a cycle where we can release functionality on a very, very fast pace back into our customers in order to do that. And the release scores in terms of how we measure the quality of the release has gone up tremendously also in the 90%. So fundamental benefits in terms of investing with your partner. I think one of the other levers that you can pull is around continuous improvement. I think the myth is that you may think you're doing continuous improvement, but look at yourself in the mirror and ask yourself if you're really doing that. There's tons of articles on continuous improvement. There's a body of knowledge around all this. But I just bring a couple of things in terms of practice that I think people don't necessarily think about. The use of change advisory boards with decision authority on a template, especially a global template. Okay, that group has got to have the power to say no and be supported by senior managers. Okay? And if you can do that, you can drive your continuous improvement efforts in the correct direction. The use of heat maps, which I'll get into in the next slide. And then, one of my favorites is metrics. You need the metrics for continuous improvement. But they need to be metrics that are public, that are available for everybody. They need to be transparent, so everybody understands how they're calculated. And they need to be put into an organizational structure where it's not a retributive kind of event where if you get a bad number, somebody's on your case. I think if you get into an environment where you can show that you're taking a bad number and making it better and better all the time, I think that's the kind of environment you want to be in order to use these metrics correctly. I think there's a number of challenges around this area. There's an assumption that if your program has been successful, it's met on time, on budget, in full, I know there's very few that do that, but then it can transition to a continuous improvement state automatically. And that is an erroneous assumption. It can't do that. So people think it can just move forward. Funding is typically an issue. It's typically not included afterwards. So all of a sudden, funding dries up. And then, of course, funding dries up, and you typically don't have headcount. So I think some of the challenges is to think beyond the end of your project, which everybody seems to be focusing on. Let me talk a little bit about heat maps. So this is usage patterns. What you see on the column are a set of capabilities, okay, that we just pulled up. Across the top are actually countries, which I've removed the countries so I protect the innocent, all right? And what you see in this particular case is when we go into a country and we talk to them about what functionality they need, you're starting to see in this the fact that we are brokering that conversation around. You may not be at stage three, maybe you're at stage one, so you only need some of these capabilities. But you're starting to see it's sort of a little bit of a menu option with a lot of direction and push and challenge, certainly from a global standpoint. The important thing is once all that has happened and both parties have agreed, we contract what will be put in. Once we contract what will be put in, we have an idea of how much change management, of course, needs to happen along with that. And we also have an idea of how much more benefits are potentially available for that particular country afterwards. And we do that, we contract, we get the functionality, and we get them up and running. What's important is the block afterwards on the side around usage. The minute they go live, we start tracking usage across those modules that we had agreed together that they would use. And because we're visibly tracking that, it provides us the opportunity to go have an honest conversation with them and ask them, you had said you were going to do X, Y, Z, but we're not seeing a usage in the system. We're not seeing what you're supposed to be doing. Let's have a conversation around why. Why is that happening? Is it the training was inefficient? Is it, you've got organizational issues? You've got too many other issues. But that allows that conversation to continuously improve the use of the product once it's landed in that particular country. The last lever that I want to talk about that I've put up is around governance. And I think there's a myth around you put a group of people in a room, you give them a mandate, and they automatically form a governance body. And I think the practice, the correct practice, is one around form really does follow function. All right? You need to understand the function that you want the governance body to do, and then the form of that is going to come afterwards. So if you are trying to drive a change program in Indonesia, where you're having to deal with VPs of finance and VPs of customer development, and your governance body is fundamentally made up of directors sitting in the UK, I will tell you what all those directions and decisions are going to end up being. So you need to make sure you've got the correct organizational hierarchy in that governance body to drive the change. I also think you need two types of governance bodies. I think you need one that's global to drive a level of convergence and what we want to do globally. And I think you need a governance body that is actually embedded within the particular country that you want to land in, because they have the accountability to drive acceptance. And you need to be very careful about setting up those two governance bodies, because they need to support one another going forward. I think the challenge around those governance bodies is getting the time from senior executives and leaders to serve on them. And that's always a challenge in order to do that. And I think the other challenge is those governance bodies typically will disband when the program is over, when the program is deemed complete. And in actual fact, that's when the majority of the change management aspects start triggering in full, when you actually start seeing data coming back, you start seeing lack of benefits starting to come in as an MCO, as a country, are starting to activate that. And that's when they need to keep going. So what I've tried to do is suggest to you that, you know, a good promotion, an efficient promotion, is actually the result of a number of things. And in a world where everything is changing around you, you know, my suggestion is look for a number of levers, okay, and look for levers around people, processes, and systems. And if you have evidence of those levers and you've got them activated correctly, chances are that you will regularly do that. So do you have a strong business framework that is robust, that stood the test of time, and actually can adapt to the different MCOs or different countries you're going into? You know, I didn't talk about collaboration with customers, but you need to do that. That's an ante-in these days. You've got to have a level of joint business planning with your customers and collaboration with your customers. Your analytics, backwards looking, that's an ante-in. Forward looking, I think it's tread with care, but you've got to go down that road to understand how to leverage that potential. You've got to make sure your solutions are fit for purpose. Okay? And that is the beginning of making sure that you're going to get some level of usability and adoption, but you have to focus on usability and adoption. Implementation maintainability, I talked about, getting that partner. Continuous improvement. The program isn't over once you've declared success and you've gone live. It takes a lot of time to drive that organizational change in. And then, of course, the governance that supports and allows that change to happen. So again, if you pull on all those levers correctly, you'll continue to improve your spend year over year is what I'm suggesting. So with that, I'm hoping I was on target and gave you a couple of different ways to think about things, certainly on a global program point of view.
And with that, thank you very much, Ron.